Good evening, my friends. My name is Rodney. It's wonderful to be here with you at worship on this Feast of All Saints. We take time to remember all of those important people in our lives who have been witnesses for us, who have supported us and taught us what it means to be a disciple of Jesus the Christ. We take this whole week to remember many, and especially those who have died in the past year. So we won't be doing that tonight. We'll be doing that on Sunday and next Wednesday. But tonight, we're very excited to welcome those of you who are joining us on our recorded service. In preparation for our worship tonight, I invite you, if you haven't already, light a candle in your environment. Bring some bread, some fruit of the vine near you so that you can pray along with us. Those wonderful words of institution that Christ gave us, that you can participate with us in that meal of grace and love that we will celebrate together later in our worship. Welcome, everybody. Let's just take a deep breath together. Allow ourselves just to land in this space. Yes, you do get to exhale very gently. It's wonderful to have you all here in this space. Feel the closeness of your God, as close to you as your own breath. Ruach, breath of God, Holy Spirit animating us, drawing us together, calling us to be the body of Christ tonight. Let any anxiety, any worry, any busyness of the day just melt away. This is where you need to be, no other place in the world. And I say that because we have the wonderful opportunity tonight to worship with Bishop Amy Current, who has come to join us. And so I want to invite Bishop to come forward and to greet you and to share some opening words with you.
Every microphone's different, so there we go. It is good to be with you all on this day. My name, as Pastor Blummel said, is Amy Current. I serve as your bishop, and it is my privilege, sincere privilege, to be here today. And I'm going to name the obvious, but it's Wednesday, and this is a full church. And this isn't only a full church, but this is a full church of the generations. And I am just really thankful to be able to be among you. This is pretty cool. So it is fun. I hope you've had a good night so far, and you've had some time to learn and to connect with one another, and now we get to worship together. And I'm just like really moved. It was moving to watch you come in to this space. So I'm here today. And I'm here today because I was invited. Because one of the great things that I get to do as Bishop of the Synod is to preach, preside, accompany, walk with, and equip all of the saints in the body of Christ all through southeastern Iowa. And so that is 136 worshiping communities. Many of them look a lot like this. Some are tiny, some are huge. But they're all filled with the people of God, just like each one of you today. And that's what I get to do. It's a really cool thing. And then I also, anybody know what this is? What does this look like? Go for it. What do you think it is? Yeah, it's a staff. That's right. And who usually uses a staff? Anybody know? Yeah, go ahead. Old people, right? Yes, that's exactly it. You use it often as a cane to walk around and to help you walk, right? Do you know what else it can be used for? It can be used by a shepherd. So you know how, like, sometimes these kinds of things use us to stabilize? And that's one of the cool things I get to do as a bishop. I get to help communities to walk together, to understand one another. Do you know what else shepherds do with this? Sometimes they like guide their sheep, right? And so that's another thing I get to do. Like a shepherd who guides their sheep, I get to teach and I get to help and I get to help people learn. And I get to work with people like your pastor and all of the other pastors and deacons that guide us and teach us and preach and share joy in Jesus Christ. So it's good to be with you today. I want to share with you my thanksgiving for all of the ways in which you are a congregation. You show up for each other. You support one another. You reach out to one another. You learn together. You worship together. You reach beyond your walls of this congregation into your community, into the world. And some of the ways you do that is through your offering, through the ways in which you share of your own things for the good of the church. And that might be in money. It might also be in the way you share your time. It might be the way that you share your talents or you reach out in your community. And I give you thanks for the ways in which you do that and for the ways in which you join all of the other congregations, all of the churches that do the same thing. We call that mission support, which I think is just a crazy word. But what it means is that we support one another in sharing the story of Jesus. And we get to do that all together. And when each one of us does that, it multiplies. And people that haven't yet heard the story of Jesus begin to listen. And then they learn, and then the body of Christ grows. And that's the cool thing we get to do together. So I hope we can do a little bit of that tonight. Bonus, this bishop gets to be here tonight when people get Bibles. I want you to know I have told no less than 14 people today about the fact that I get to be here when people get Bibles. So I'm guessing some of you are those that will receive your Bible, and I am so excited. And Pastor allowed me to pray. So I'm just going to say to you two things that I love, teaching about communion and teaching people how to use their Bible. So this is a bonus night for me in Anamosa. So thanks for having me on this day. My sermon's going to be a sermon tonight, and then I was telling Pastor that it's going to work on me the rest of the week, and so come back on Sunday, because you might hear an entirely different sermon. So we'll see. Thank you for having me, and know that we pray for you and appreciate your prayers for us. Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Bishop. I want to invite you all to rise. And let us begin our prayer this evening by remembering our baptisms.
Uh-oh.
Thank you. Let's remember our baptisms and make the sign of the cross that was made on us at our baptisms as we say, in the name of the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sanctifier, Amen. We come together called to be body of Christ in the world, lovers in the world, and we recognize when we come together to worship that we sometimes fall short of that calling, of that desire our God has for us. Sometimes we're selfish, we're greedy. Sometimes we look past those who need us to be present to them, to say a kind word. Sometimes we gossip. Sometimes we engage in things that aren't healthy for us. We recognize those as part of our lives and our human state, but that is not who we are. And so we lift them up to God tonight, asking for forgiveness and grace and healing. So call to mind and heart those places of sin in your own lives. Let us confess our sin together in the presence of God and of one another, as we say. Let us pray together our prayer of confession. Have mercy on us, O God. We confess that we have sinned against you and against our neighbor. We have built walls instead of tables and have turned away the stranger. We have sought glory for ourselves and have treasured that which does not satisfy. Help us to love as you love, to welcome those you send, and to treasure mercy and justice. Turn us from our ways to your ways, and free us to serve those in need. Amen. My friends, God, who makes all things new, forgives your sins for Christ's sake, and remembers them no more. Lift up your heads, lift up your hearts, for yours is the kingdom of God. Amen.
Remain standing as we offer our praise, withstanding the promises and the privilege I have to stand here and look at these Bibles that are beginning out in a little bit, to think about all of those promises that are for us in that Bible from God, and how exciting it is that you're going to be reading about those promises and knowing that those promises are true. They never change. They are here every day. Here we go.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of Christ the Lord. Bound to him eternal blue by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fail, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Please pray with me using the words on our screen. Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
I invite you to please be seated at this time.
As Kylene makes her way to the front to lead us in our Bible bestowal ritual tonight, I want to invite our third and fourth graders to please stand up and exit your pews right now. Just stay close to the pew that you are in, because we have 11 of you, and we're going to need lots of space. Guys, why don't you come on over here and spread over here. Okay. And you guys, move back, because I'm going to have your parents come and join you where you are. You guys up here, stay up here. Okay. Now I'm going to try to pass out your Bibles to you, and I'm going to have your parents come and join you out in the aisles and have you spread out a little ways.
All right. And while we do that, the congregation, we're going to sing a song that talks about God's word, Thy word.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You're the light unto my path.
In our lives of faith, St. Paul Lutheran Church believes it is important to teach our children how to use the Bible. The stories contained in the Bible and how those stories intersect with their lives. We believe that it is vital to give families the tools they need to be the faith mentors to their children and to gift the children in our congregation with the things they need to be faith-filled disciples of Jesus. Kids, all of you, when your family brought to you for baptism, they promised to place in your hands the Bible, to nurture your lives in faith and in prayer, to share with others the message of Jesus, to care for others and all that God has made. On that same day, the congregation promised to help your family with that promise. Today, we take an important step towards that promise by giving you these Bibles. The Bible is filled with God's story, stories of God's people, and our story too. We celebrate your growing ability to read and to understand God's word. We have chosen a Bible that we hope will help you and your family learn God's story so that it becomes part of your story too. We pray you will take these Bibles and use them, finding your favorite stories and verses. And in these Bibles, Pastor, along with your parents, have filled out or written a little something special in these Bibles with other our favorite verses or stories that are in those Bibles. And I encourage all of you guys, when you guys get home, to ask your parents if they have not signed your Bible, to sign your Bibles, because these are the most important things that you guys will be using for the rest of your lives.
So, young folks, I'd invite you to hold your Bible out in front of you so that your parents can place a hand on the Bible and a hand on your head or your shoulder. And parents, yeah, so it's most helpful if you face your parents. That's probably the easiest thing. Parents, I'm going to invite you to pray this prayer, repeating after me. This is the word of the Lord. May this Bible be a means of blessing for you. May you read and study God's word. May God speak to you as you learn. And may you rejoice in its good news. And the young people have learned a verse, part of Psalm 119. Young people, I would invite you to say back to your parents, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Did they do it okay? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. That's what we were just singing. Bishop, would you please bless these young people and their Bibles?
Let us pray. Gracious God, bless these Bible, the people who give them, and the children who receive them. Speak to all of us that we may know the promise of your love, trust your grace, and follow in your way of life. We pray through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And all the people say,
Amen. Amen. Invite you all to be seated for the proclamation of the word.
As they sit down and our reader comes forward to read God's word, we're going to sing one more fun little Bible song that you might know from when your Sunday school days. Here we go.
The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's a book for me.
Oh, louder.
And stand alone on the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E.
Here we go.
The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E.
Let's try it one more time. Here we go.
The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the word of God. The B-I-B-L-E.
Good evening. Our first reading will be from the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 25, verse 6 through 9. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats, and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all the peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him, and he saved us. This is our Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Please join me in reading Psalm 24 together. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by a false god. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the kings of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory.
Our second reading is from the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said to me, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of life. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The The Holy Gospel according to John, the 11th chapter. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said to him, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. There's lots of things here in this text, but today I want to talk about the very last verse. And part of why I want to talk about this very last verse is because it fits with all of the other texts today in my mind. And so remember the story, right? So here we have this beloved friend of Jesus. His name was Lazarus, and his sisters, Mary and Martha, they were all friends of Jesus, and they'd gotten to know one another. We believe that they had had meals together, that they had learned together, that these were Jesus' disciples, Mary, Martha, Lazarus, along with all the 12 that we all know and learn about, right? And so it seems that Jesus had some sense that Lazarus was not well when Mary came running, right, and said to him, "You know, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died." And then a little bit later, we hear people say, like, "If he can make a blind person see, can't he prevent this man from dying?" And then we hear a little bit later where Jesus says to Martha, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" Right? And so we have all of this building in this story. And there is so many things to think about in the story, but the most important part happens at the very end. There was a man dead in a tomb for 4 days. Now, this is not pleasant, but the story is very clear. Does anybody know what happens when a person is in a tomb for 4 days? They begin to smell, right? So Martha's like, "Jesus, now we believe in you, right? But please don't move that stone. Because it's bad enough that our brother has died, but we're grieving. Don't mess with this man. We want to have him be at peace. You should have been here 4 days ago," right? And Jesus says, "Believe in me," right? Now, I find this whole story a little bit perplexing because I don't know about you, but when I hear this story, I struggle a bit because here we are celebrating the Feast of All Saints. This is the week, the day, the moment in our lives where we remember one by one the people whom we have loved, the people whom we have respected, the people like Lazarus that are friends and family that we have grieved and have died, right? And so we remember this. We know what Mary and Martha and all of their friends were feeling, deep grief. And what we know here is that Jesus felt it too. This is every confirmation student's favorite verse in the Bible. Two words, Jesus wept. It's the best because it's the shortest, easiest to memorize. But guess what? It's the best because Jesus wept. It's the story where we see Jesus' deep love for his people. Sometimes we talk about feeling it in our guts, right? That we love somebody so much that we almost feel sick to our stomach. And that's what we're told in this story, that Jesus is so sad for his friends, so sad for this loss. Yet what we know as the people of God is that the story doesn't end in the tomb, right? What we know is that because of Jesus, we know this. Mary and Martha and all of those people gathered there that day, they were just getting glimpses. But we know that because of Jesus, because of the cross of Jesus, that people are set free in death. And although we grieve, that people are promised life eternal. Now that all gets me a little bit ahead of myself here, because what happens here at the tomb is Jesus yells anyway, "Lazarus, come out." And guess what happens? That man walks out of the tomb after being in there 4 days. It's a miracle, really. And he walks out and he doesn't smell. So win, right? But also, he walks out, but do you know what happens when he walks out? He is still in all of what we call the grave clothes. So these days, I don't know how many people have been to a funeral, but I'm guessing some of you here have been to a funeral. When we think about people being buried, we often put people in either their what we call the Sunday best, right? Their most formal clothes, or we dress people in the clothes that they're most comfortable in, right? Well, in these days, people were wrapped. They were wrapped with spices to avoid that smell, and they were wrapped in cloth, right? And so here comes Lazarus out of the tomb, and he is bound up. He's wound up. And so this week of Halloween, I can't help but think about the mummy costumes, right? I know that you're probably thinking, wow, this bishop is a little bit nutty, but it's been on my mind. And I think it's been on my mind because of this, because I don't know if y'all have done this, but I've played those games where you take a roll of toilet paper and you wrap it around, right? And you look like you begin to wrap yourself. And now if we use toilet paper for that, it's pretty easy to break free, right? You can kind of get out of that. But here, Lazarus was wound tightly. People had cared for his body. They had wrapped him, they had washed him, they had wrapped him in spices. They wanted him to be cared for and laid to rest in this tomb. And so when he comes out, what does Jesus say? Untie him and let him go. This is not something that Lazarus can do on his own. But instead, Lazarus needs all of the people, all of the people that surround him and love him and have been weeping for him to begin to untie him and let him go. So can you imagine that with me, right? You start pulling off and Lazarus begins to step into new life. And he's no longer carrying those grave clothes, but he is living and he's free to live. So I've been thinking about how this happens to us, right? Because there's lots of ways that we are held back. There's lots of ways where we're wrapped up. There's lots of ways in which we get put into a tomb or hidden away or isolated or prevented from being alive, right? And that doesn't mean that we're dead without breath. This means that we are dead because of sin. It means that we become wrapped up in ourselves. I don't know about you, but I think that I'm pretty good at sinning. It's not something I'm proud of, but it's true. I fall short. I make mistakes. I turn on my friends and my neighbors sometimes. Sometimes I say things that aren't very nice. Sometimes I deal harshly with people that I shouldn't. Sometimes I'm hard on myself. Sometimes my sin is what I do to myself. Because sometimes when I don't think I'm good enough, or if I feel ashamed about myself, or if I believe that because of something I've done, even if it's long over and people have forgiven me for that, I still believe that God judges me. Sometimes I believe that I am not welcome, that I shouldn't have a right to show up to places like church or to something that is a time of celebration, like a feast. Sometimes I don't feel like I'm worthy to make the sign of the cross on my head because of the ways in which I have fallen short for myself or others. Sometimes I just don't believe I measure up enough. And then I think about the fact that God's promise is to surround us with people, to join us there. This is a God that promises to make all things new. This is the God that wants for us a new heaven and a new earth. This is the God for us that comes to us when we are weeping, weeps with us, and then promises to wipe the tears from our face. And we don't do this on our own. We do this with the God who loves us, the God who claims us in baptism and sets us free, the God who unties us from all of our sin every single day. That's the promise of baptism. This is the God who welcomes every single one of us to the feast of life, to the communion table, where we eat and drink forgiveness and mercy and love, where we're unfurled from all of our sin and set free to live. Right? Just like Lazarus, all of those things that keep us from one another and from God are stripped off, and we are free to live in the world. No matter what we carry, our fear, our grief, our doubt, our pain, our shame, God meets us, and God wipes our tears from our eyes and sets us free. Because we have a God that is for us, not against us. We have a God that joins us when we're sad and suffering and then promises us life anew. This is the good news of the gospel. And the good news of the gospel is in the stories of our Bibles, right? I loved and I chuckled a little bit when I saw the Bibles that these kids were given tonight. I don't know if you've seen them, all of you, but it's called the Adventure Bible, right? Because that's what God invites us on, the adventure of life, the life of faith, the journey of faith in community, where we're connected to one another, where we don't journey alone, but we journey together as the body of Christ in the world, so that when we suffer, we are surrounded not only by those of us sitting here today, not only the larger congregation, right, but all of the saints of God. And I think this is a miraculous thing to understand. But Lazarus, Mary, Martha, and maybe some grandmas and grandpas, or your neighbor next door, or whoever that you are thinking about today that has died, plus everyone that is a baptized person of God that God celebrates and creates is a saint of God. And this is the body of Christ. And we together live tied together and set free so that we can be unfurled. Unbind them and let them go, Jesus says. And so you know what we get to do? We get to take these stories and share them with the entire world. We get to share the love of Jesus wherever we go. And if we mess up, we remember that we are baptized and that Jesus stands right with us and calls to us again and again, come out. And then together we unbind ourselves within the community and are set free. Set free to love and serve the Lord. And this is the beautiful good news of God that we get to do. This is why we show up. This is why we come together. This is why we begin with confessing our sins and are sent out with a meal of forgiveness, because we can share that story with all that we meet. Thank you for being partners in the body of Christ, in the water, in the word, in the feast that we share. In Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to stand as you are able. As we offer our praise with "Because He Lives." Confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed, we say together.
We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, she is worshiped and glorified. She has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Having been formed in the Word of God and in faith, we are called to pray together for the world and for each other. As Nylan and Reese come forward to lead us in our prayers of intercession, I invite you to think about your own lives, those people, those situations that you would like to join to the prayers of the church at this time.
Eternal God, you hold firm amid the changes of this world. Hear us now as we pray for the church, the world, and everyone in need.
Is that better? Let's try again. Eternal God, you hold firm amid the changes of this world. Hear us now as we pray for the church, the world, and everyone in need. Merciful God, we give thanks for all missionaries who have brought your message of hope to new communities and wipe away tears. Continue to raise up courageous missionaries to share your gospel of hope. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating God, will we praise you for abundant harvest and the goodness of creation. Create communities of care for your earth so that all land, water, and soil will be celebrated and cherished by future generations. O saints, hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of peace, we give you thanks for nations of peace that serve as a refuge for all whose homelands are afflicted with violence. Strengthen those who continue to work for peace and support all veterans who carry the scars of war. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of healing, we give you thanks for health care workers who labor around the clock to answer cries for help, bring holiness to all who struggle with post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety, depression, addiction, and all who long for healing in any way. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of justice, we praise you for feeding ministries and for all meals that bring people together for nourishment and fellowship. Bless chefs, bakers, servers, dishwashers, union assistants. Bless our local restaurant owners who provide places for people to gather for fellowship and rest. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of the ages, we give you thanks for the saints of this congregation who have inspired, challenged, loved, and taught us, wipe away our tears, and lead us by their example until we feast together on your holy mountain. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God, our protection and strength, we bring your kingdom and the power of Jesus Christ over the bodies, minds, and spirits of each member of our congregation and against evil and foul spirits that come against us. And we entrust you, all for whom we pray. We entrust to you, all for whom we pray. Remain with us always through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen. My friends, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Take a moment to share with those around you a sign of Christ's peace as you are comfortable. Shalom. 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 The mystery of Christ's peace is beyond our understanding. We share it with each other because it makes a difference. The energy in this place changes as we share Christ's peace. That energy of the world changes, an energy of healing that is so desperately needed. Thank you for sharing that peace. Thank you also for sharing your time, your treasure, your talent. It is with grateful hearts for the ways that you support our mission and our vision here at St. Paul, an outreach to the world, that we bring our voices together at this point in our worship to pray together our offering prayer. Holy God, the earth is yours and everything in it. Let your son dwell among your creatures. Come among us now in these gifts of bread and wine, and strengthen us to be your body for the world through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. You renew the church in every age by raising up men and women outstanding in holiness, living witnesses of your unchanging love. They inspire us by their faithful lives and help us by their constant prayers to be the living sign of your saving power. We praise you, Lord, with all the angels and saints in their song of joy. In the power of Holy Spirit, we now recall with great thanksgiving the memorial Christ left for us as we sing, "Remember Now, My Children."
Together we have great times.
We join our voices together as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. My friends, the risen Christ has left us this memorial meal of love, that we who hunger and thirst might be fed and be satisfied. Come, eat the bread of life, drink the cup of salvation, and be united in the love of our God. We'll invite you to come down the center aisle if you'd like to receive communion from Bishop Current. Immediately behind her will be trays. In the center of the trays, the lighter color juice is grape juice. The outer rings, the purple ones, are wine. There will be two tables. Please help yourselves to the blood of Christ, and you can place your empty glasses in the baskets along the outside aisles. Blood of Christ shed for you.
Even when my eyes can't see.
mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea.
invite you to rise. Let us pray together with thanksgiving. Blessed Jesus, at this table you have been for us both host and meal. Now send us forth to extend our tables and to share your gifts until that day when all feast together at your heavenly banquet. Amen. Before we receive our final blessing from Bishop Current, want to invite you to come through the fellowship hall on your way out tonight, where you will find cookies and some refreshments and an opportunity to greet Bishop Current in person. Not only did you receive communion from her, but you can say hi to her too. So please come downstairs.
Awesome. God, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, who has written your name in the book of life, bless you and keep you in grace and peace from this time forth forevermore. Amen.
As we remember our saints that have gone before us, to know that someday too we will fly away and be with them where joys are overflowing. Let's sing "I'll Fly Away." Together to say, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we go into the world to creatively connect, intentionally grow, and joyfully serve. Thanks be to God. And all God's people said, amen. Third and fourth graders, that Bible, best gift ever. Don't put it on a shelf. Read it every night. Have a wonderful Wednesday, and we'll see you next time.